Podcasting 2017 for the entire month of January. Okay? So I know we're used to the 21 days. I know everybody's looking at me, gave me that little look like, oh, bless the Lord. We're going past 21 days. Yes, amen. We're going past 21 days. Okay, so it'll be the whole month of January. Of course, Pastor will explain and expound on that more. But trust, he has had confirmation from the Lord that this is what we need to do this go round. Amen. So he's not doing this so we just don't eat for 30 days, but we actually get to eat, but it'll just be different eating. Let's just put it like that. But this will be that time of, once again, for us to just sacrifice and say, God, you're more important than the food that I put in my body. And my time with you is more important than how I eat, when I eat, how long I eat. We're going to spend that time praying and seeking his face and finding out what he wants us to do in 2017. Amen. Amen. So let's look forward to that. In January, it's happening. And we're going to do it, New Life, because we've done it before. And God has helped us every single time we've done it. So there's no need to fear the 30 days. Just know that God has got your back and he has not given us the spirit of fear. So therefore, he's already made ways in preparation for us to handle it. Amen. Amen. Our ushers are coming forward. If you need an envelope for your giving this morning, please raise your hand and they will make sure that you receive one for your giving. We're going to worship the Lord and we're going to honor the Lord. And Pastor's going to come forward. Brother Kevin has a testimony. Amen. We love testimonies. See how God is doing in other people's lives. Amen. Hallelujah.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Before I get started, there's four people that I need to thank. Well, probably more than that, but just calls in the Bible to give credit and stuff where it's due. And first person I want to thank is Sister Kim, because she invited me and my family here about 12 years ago. And I just wanted to thank her for that, because my whole life has been changed since I come here. And excuse me. It was hard at first, because I'm going to tell you, the devil, and I'm not going to tell you everything, there's no need in all that, because I just want to tell you how good God is. But I was so low that when I looked up, I was under the devil. Under the devil. And I remember something Bishop said one time, and I'll never forget it. He said, if you're under the devil, all you got to do is stand up. Because we're higher than the devil. Amen. He's already been defeated, you know. So I stood up. But it's like people, the devil was trying to beat me down. I done been through everything that you can go through in life. And I didn't think I was going to make it. But Pastor and Bishop, they told me what was right. They told me don't stop believing God and don't stop coming, and I never did. And about 4 years, I've been going through. Oh man, excuse me, but I already know what hell's like because I've been through it here, so I know I definitely don't want to go to it at the end of days.
Amen. Amen.
So I said I'm not going there, no. But it was hard at first because I made a terrible, terrible mistake. I started talking to people. Oh, man, you can't imagine what some of the people will say to you. I mean, they don't mean no harm, but, oh, they cause so much harm. And I feel so much anger. Every emotion you could imagine, I went through because I was just beat down. And then talking about that Daniel fast. Well, I would tell you, that thing works. Because what happened to me was because of that Daniel fast. Not this past time, but the year before. That's when everything started breaking loose. I'm telling you, the first week, though, was hard. Because you used to eating Krispy Kreme and Pepsis and all that stuff. Your body's going to rebel. It rebelled. My body rebelled. But after I got through that first week, I said, this is good. So I quit talking to people. Because, you know, they just don't understand. If you ain't never been through what you know, everybody knows if you ain't been through what you've been through, you wouldn't know how to respond to nobody. So, but we start on that fast. I started talking to God. And, you know, I know in the Bible it says be content with what you have. But I didn't have two nickels rubbed together. So I'm like, I've got to be content with this. God's more than this. So anyway, but like Miss Devin said, and Miss Candace, and even Miss Shauna, one time she said they write their stuff down. That's good. God is so good, you don't even have to write nothing down. Because he told me in that fast, in dreams, what he had in store for me. Because I had been saying, well, that's it. You know, I'm beat down. I ain't got nothing. I don't have no car. I ain't got no job. I ain't got no place to live. I'm a grown man. I don't have nowhere to live. They done kicked me out. Like, what am I going to do? I didn't have no money. Didn't have nothing. But I just started talking to God. Day, night after night, I couldn't sleep. Night after night, I was just talking to him all night long. After about 4 days, I said, Lord, I said, I'm working. I got to get some sleep, you know. I said, you got to give me some sleep. So he will. When your body gets tired enough, you'll sleep. So I slept. I was sleeping. That's when the dream came. And I woke up 3 o'clock in the morning like somebody hit me in the head with a hammer. And I sat straight up in the bed. And he said, you need to go get you a house. I said, go get a house? I mean, how in the world am I going to do that? I said, I go to the bank, they're going to laugh at me. But this is how good God is. He puts people in place.
Yes. Yes.
People in place.
Yes.
If your faith is lacking, he'll put other people in place to pick you up.
Yes, he will.
So, when I go out in the world, a lot of people may not know me, but I like to have fun and cut up with people, especially like if I'm shopping or whatever, talking to people. So I just went up to the credit union, messing with this lady that I met up there, and she was real nice and all. And I said, I already knew because I know about how doing all credit and all that stuff, but I said, that's out the window because that, you know, I got bad credit and everything. So I said, what do I need to do to buy a house? You know, just kind of poking fun and picking at her. And she said, fill out an application. I said, what do you mean fill out an application? I said, you don't know what I done been through. She said, fill out an application. So that fast, it works. Anyway, long story short, God did all that for me from nothing. And it took a long time now. We had to do a lot, me and that lady, but she stood by me. Well, God did most of it, but he put her there. And he told me what to do and how to do it, and she helped me along. And August 12th, 2015... August 12th.
Hallelujah! Glory to God!
Hallelujah!
I went from being under the devil's belly to sitting right beside my God and your God, my brother Jesus. He lifted me up when I thought everything was over with. There ain't nothing ever over with God. Oh, I forgot. The most important part for me. This thing right here. See, I have filled this up with word. It was going in these eyes and in these ears every day. And I said, this stuff, I mean, that's one thing I didn't understand. I said, when you get saved, you're supposed to be smooth sailing. Everything's supposed to be good. And that's what I had to learn the hard way. That's what made me mad, really, because this stuff's not supposed to happen to me because I'm saved. I love the Lord. But once I filled this up, and then all of a sudden it got so full that it started spitting out of here. Once I started spitting it out, he did the rest.
Stand on your feet, because this is a perfect time to start praising the Lord. Now the ushers are gonna come up and you give as you want to. You praise and worship like we say every Sunday. This is a praise party, New Life. God is teaching us how they do it in heaven. And in heaven they goes all out when they come to praising and worshiping God. So as New Life, we're learning how to have a praise party here on earth. Amen. So one thing I ask everybody, don't get distracted by the people that's jumping around and praising the Lord. That's how they praise. I'm just going to put it like that. If they jump around and dance around and they hit you and bump you, please forgive them, because they're praising their God, because they only know how good he's been to them. So if you just jump in and jump around, trust me, you'll bump into some people too, because only you know how good God has been to you. So that's why we worship God. So worship God how you do it. But all I ask you to do is just worship him and give him praise, because he's worthy of it. Hallelujah. Play that song, Charles. He's a God of turnaround. He's a God of turnaround. Ain't that right, Brother Kevin? Turn it around, open the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing, overflow. Turn it around, open the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing, we cannot contain. Let it rain. Come on, say, let it rain.
Nothing's too difficult.
Say it again. All things
are possible.
Oh yes, they are.
All things are possible.
Nothing's too difficult for you.
Because
I'm ready for change.
Ready for change. Ready for rain. Ready for favor. I know you are able.
So turn it around. Open the windows of heaven.
simple faith. All things are possible.
Nothing's too difficult.
Nothing's too difficult.
Nothing's
too difficult.
Because I'm ready for change.
Ready for change.
Ready for aid.
Ready for favor.
I know you are able. Overflow,
turn it around. Open the windows of heaven.
Pour out all the blessings
we cannot contain.
Turn it around.
Open the windows.
Oh yes, and pour out a blessing. Overflow,
turn it around.
Open the windows of heaven.
Pour
out all the blessings
we cannot
God to pour out a blessing that we cannot contain. Hallelujah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You have turned my morning to dancing. You turned my sorrow to joy. You turned my whole life around. And I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, you have turned. Come on, say that. My morning to dancing,
you turned.
Come on, New Life, sing it. My sorrow to joy, you have turned. My whole life around, and I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you have turned. Open up your mouth and say it. My morning to dancing, you turned. My sorrow to joy, you have turned. My whole life around, and I thank you. Come on, say it again.
Thank
you, have turned.
You have turned
my morning to dancing. You turned my sorrow to joy. You have turned
my whole life around, and I thank you, Lord.
Come on, say
thank
it again.
You have turned. You have turned my morning to dancing. You turned my sorrow to joy. You have turned my life around.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank
come
you,
on, start turning around. Come on.
Open the windows of heaven. Pour out a blessing. Overflow. Turn it around. Open the windows of heaven. Pour out a blessing.
We cannot contain.
Say, open the windows of heaven. Pour out a blessing. Overflow. We cannot contain.
Come on, say it again.
Contain.
Come on, say it again.
Contain. Let it rain.
Hallelujah. 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 We talk about the God of turnaround, right? How many people are glad he's your friend? How many people are glad you can say, I have a friend and his name is Jesus? I know that God is my friend. He calls me friend. We're going to sing about how we are a friend of God. Hallelujah. Come on and sing it with us. I am a friend of God. Come on and say it.
I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Great and mighty, you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. Isn't that good news? Is this true? That you are thinking of me, how you love me. It's amazing, ooh, and wonderful.
And mighty, you
come
are
on and sing it with us, New Life.
Me,
that you hear me,
that you hear me
when I call,
when I call.
And it is true, oh Lord,
is it true that you are thinking of me?
Oh, how you love
how
me.
How you love me.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
Come on and say it.
I am a friend of God.
Oh, is
great and mighty. You are mindful of me.
You're mindful of me.
That you hear me.
Oh, I'm glad to hear me.
When I call.
And it is true, oh Lord.
Is it true that you are thinking of me?
Oh, how you love
how
me.
You love me.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
Part. He's God Almighty, Lord of glory. You have called me friend. Come on and sing it today.
God Almighty,
he's the Lord of glory.
You have called me friend.
You have called
yes, you have. But yet he's still our friend. Hallelujah. Come on and say it again. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
Oh,
I am a friend of God. You call me friend.
You
call me friend. You call me friend.
You
call me friend.
Hallelujah. They say no greater love than a man that would lay down his life for a friend. What does that take to be an awesome friend that he would lay down his life and he didn't even know you? But he knew of you, that you would be here for a purpose and a time such as this, that he would lay down his life for you. What an awesome friend. Hallelujah. That is the friend we sing about. Y'all will worship with us in here today? Hallelujah. Sing this next song with us, okay? Hallelujah. Thank you.
Thank you for all you've done.
Say it through your son.
Through your son. Thank you for all you do. Cause you brought me through when I look around and see where I've been. You've been a friend. Glory,
honor,
honor, exaltation, power, blessing, worship, love without end. Cause you've been a friend. Oh,
there's not a friend.
There's not a friend like you. Ooh.
Thank you for hiding me.
For protecting me.
When
I could
not see.
Not see.
Thank you for hiding me.
Thank you for hiding.
Under
the shadow of your wings.
Come on, say it.
Cause when I look around and I see you again, you've been a friend. Glory, honor, exaltation, power, blessing, worship,
it's the love without end.
You've been a friend. Glory
and
honor, exaltation, power, blessing, and worship, a love without end.
Cause
you've been a friend. Oh, there's not a friend like you. Ooh.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. All we have to do is take it to the Lord in prayer. Come on, lift up your voice and say,
oh, oh, what a friend I have in you.
Come on and lift up your voice and say, say, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, what a friend I have in you.
Come on and shout it out. I love this next part. It's a love without end. A love without end. Come on, say it's a love. A love without end. It is a love. A love without end. Cause you've been a friend. Oh, 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 oh. That's not a friend. That's not a friend like you. Come on and lift your hands and praise your friend.
Hallelujah. We're going to sing it.
Hallelujah.
Again. We're going to sing it again.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That's a tap-in spot right there. Hallelujah. That's a tapping. We're going to stay right there.
Hallelujah.
We're going to stay right there. We're going to sing it again.
Hallelujah.
Since we don't have live musicians, we're just going to play the track back. We're just going to sing it again.
Hallelujah.
All right? No. Go back.
Hallelujah.
Go back. Just think on how good a friend is. You notice what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what need.
Oh, what needs we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pains we bear. It's all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Just keep worshiping the Lord. Keep worshiping
Hallelujah.
The Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for all you've done through your Son. Thank you for all you do. 'Cause you brought me through when I look around and see where I've been. You've been a friend. Glory,
honor,
exaltation,
power.
Blessing
and worship. It's a
love without end. You've been a friend.
Hallelujah.
Oh,
there's not a friend like
you. There's not a friend like you.
How about when he protects you?
For protecting me.
Danger seen and unseen.
When I could. Not see.
How about when he hides?
Thank you for hiding me under the shadow of your wings.
Every time you look
when
around,
I look
save me.
Around.
Who was there to save
and
me?
See
it was him.
You again.
Power is blessing and worship is a
love. 'Cause you've been a friend.
Glory,
honor,
exaltation, all
power
is blessing. I give you
worship
is a love
without end.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. All we have to do is take it to the Lord in prayer.
Cast your care.
Oh.
Oh. Just being there.
Oh,
A love that won't end. It's new every morning.
A love without end.
It never runs out, and it's unfailing. It's unconditional love.
A love without end.
And it's a love that he poured out on you and me.
A love without end.
Because he's such a great friend.
You've been a friend.
He's such a great friend. Oh, when we miss it, he's still a great friend.
There's not a friend like
he's never said a bad
you.
Thing about you. Ooh. Aren't you glad about that? You got a friend that's never talked behind your back. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Hallelujah. Just go right on into the next one. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, this is a beautiful place to worship right now. There might be an intercession on your heart. Just go ahead and start praying. Hallelujah.
I have a maker. He formed my heart. Oh, before even time began, my life was in his hands. Oh. And he knows my name, and he knows my every thought, and he sees each tear that falls, and hears me when
aren't you glad he
I call.
It says the prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Yeah.
I have a father.
I have a father.
So glad I have a father.
He calls me his own.
Calls me his own.
He'll never leave me.
He promised, that's what he said. Lift our hands and just begin to intercede right now. Just begin to pray. Just begin to pray. If you feel with the Holy Ghost, begin to pray in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God, thank you. 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 Glory to Namaste. Holy Spirit, we are here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Rest in this house right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just like in the upper room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We're hungry and we're thirsty. Hallelujah. We're hungry and we're thirsty. You promised that if we hunger and thirst after righteousness, we shall be filled. So, Father, we thank you that tonight, today we are unified in this building. We are hungry and we are thirsty. We're hungry and we're thirsty, right? Hallelujah. We're hungry and we're thirsty for you. Hallelujah. Your word, your presence. We want to hear from you. Hallelujah. We want to know. We thank you. We want to know your way deeper. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We release the glory in this house. Hallelujah. We release the glory in this house. We release the glory in this house. We release the glory in this house. Demonstration of your power in this house. Hallelujah. The broken will be mended in here today. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. If you're not saved, today is a day of salvation for you. Hallelujah. 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 If you're troubled in your mind, you have found a peaceful place right here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All honor, all power, all glory given unto you, God. Hallelujah. 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 We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It's turning around. Hallelujah. It's turned around. Hallelujah. It's turned around. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. It's already turned around. Hallelujah. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. Every situation turned around. Every circumstance turned around. Every problem has already been turned around. We thank you for that. We thank you for that. Your presence is here. The answer is here. Every solution is right here. We thank you for it. We draw from the well of salvation right now. Hallelujah. Draw, draw, draw. Draw from that well. Draw from that well. Draw from that well. Hallelujah. Draw from that well. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. This is how demonstration comes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is how demonstration comes. Hallelujah. You got to get in the presence of the King. Hallelujah. You can't only just have his glory in you. You got to get it on you. Hallelujah. You want it to rest on you. Hallelujah. You want power to rest on you. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We worship you, God. We worship you, God. And we are so thankful to be in your presence. We are so thankful to be in your courts. We are so thankful to receive from you right now. Hallelujah. We want everything you got. We haven't gotten enough. We want more. 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 Hallelujah. We want more. Hallelujah. We want more. Hallelujah. More of your glory. More of your power. More of your might. More of your spirit. More of your understanding. More of your wisdom. More of your love. More of your forgiveness. More of your faithfulness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The cleanness, the holiness that you are. We want more of it. We want to see it on our lives. We want to manifest it in our flesh, God. We want you to be seen. We want to be living epistles for all men to read. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want to exhibit good works that men may see us and glorify our Father. We thank you for that. Glory to God. Glory to God. You are a good work. Hallelujah. Do you hear me? You are a good work. Hallelujah. You are a masterpiece made for a good work. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Hallelujah. You're not the problem. You are the solution. You are carrying the solution in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Glory is living on the inside of you. And when you release glory, glory will be in your atmosphere. Glory will surround you. Glory will surround you on your job. Glory will surround you at your school. Glory will surround you wherever you go. Glory will surround you in your problematic family situations. Glory will be in your home, and darkness will have to get out. Because darkness cannot stay where the light of God is. The hills melt like wax in the presence of the Lord. Nothing can stand before our God. Hallelujah. This is what we've been doing the last 3 days. And this is what the Spirit of the Lord is doing. This is where we're going. Your life is about to turn around. And I don't mean like in weeks, months, and days. I'm talking about He's going to do a quick work. We are running out of time. And He is going to do a quick work. But you got to get where you need to be. And you got to reposition yourself where you need to be. I ain't talking about physically. I mean in your heart. Some pride still in here. Some pride still in here. Puffed up. And a little leaven leavens the whole lump. And that's got to go. Because you are not going to walk in this new place with that stuff in your system. I don't care how many scriptures you know, how much you pray in tongues. If you get puffed up in you, you're not going anywhere. Not with power. The Spirit of God is in here. You need to get this stuff straight. He's straightening up the house. He's straightening up the house. That is good for everybody, all the way up through past me. Past me, everybody. New life is moving in the power of the Spirit. And I hate to tell you, if you don't want to go, you're about to get left. So don't be surprised if you don't know what's going on. We're going to the other side. I done roamed in the desert for too long. We done walked around the same little mountains talking to them for too long. The cloud has moved. And it's time to go all the way in to a land flowing with milk and honey. Though the giants may be there, the Lord God fights for us. He goes before us. And when we get there, we'll find out that every giant that we thought we were going to face has already been taken care of. So fear not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Some of you got decisions you need to make. I'm telling you, you need to get in an atmosphere like this, where you can get in the presence of the Lord and the confidence of God can imprint you. And when you walk out of this atmosphere, you won't be afraid of the decision you have to make. You'll make it so confident in faith that you won't care what other people say. You'll start proclaiming stuff out of your mouth that people say, you are weird. But the same people who said you are weird will see the fruit in your life when what you said comes to pass. Because He said you shall have what you say. Yes. You need to start speaking like God. Yes. And don't be afraid to speak like Him. Don't consider yourself lowly. He said, have Christ's mind. He said He was God. He's my Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. That's the way people ought to see our lives. You see my life, you've seen the Father's life. It should be that much of a mirror image. But just putting the word in here is not going to exude the power out here. You're going to have to take that word back in there with him and bask in that word with him and let him feed that word back to you and let his presence empower you. Is everybody catching what I'm saying? Yeah. This is secret place living that I'm talking about. This is how you take that word that we talk about and begin to demonstrate. This is how the presence of God begins to saturate even your clothes. Where people who get in your vicinity are convicted. You're not going to do this on just Sunday. You're not going to even do it just on Tuesday prayer. Not even on Wednesday. This has to become a lifestyle. You got to wake up welcoming the Holy Spirit. You got to wake up talking to him. You got to wake up putting your face in the mirror of the word. And reminding yourself, before I walk out this door, who am I? I'm not under the curse of this world. I'm under the blessing of Abraham. Christ has broken that for me. So whatever conversations they're having at work, that don't count to me. Whatever they're saying about my school, that don't go to my credit. When I believe, righteousness was credited to me. As he believed, he spoke, we believe, therefore we speak. No more church as usual. But I promise you this. If you commit your way to him, you won't miss the time that you put in. Because he is a time redeemer. He'll give you more time in your day than you can count up. God, I ain't know the day was that long. Yeah, I stretched it for your sake. Don't believe me? Ask Joshua. Ask Joshua what he stretched it for your sake. We got a fight going on. Didn't we talk about that? We got a fight going on. And he's giving us victory, but you know what? That sun is going down. We can't fight in the dark. I need you to make the sun stand still. Okay, I got to make it stand still. Why? Because I already promised you, if you meditate on my word day and night, you will observe to do and you will have good success. Everywhere you put your foot, I give it to you. So that means even if I got to stop the sun so you can get this land that I promised you, I'll stop it. You're not going to start believing like that until you begin to get in there and start. Impregnate me with all your thoughts. Impregnate me with all your thoughts. I'm tired of being conformed to this world. I'm tired of being conformed to a frailty of humanity. I'm tired of looking at myself through my flesh. I'm tired of looking at myself through my resources. I'm tired of looking at myself by what I do and don't have. I want to look at myself at what you already given me. I want to look at myself as the only begotten son. I want to look at myself as the one who has been raised to life in Christ. The one who all the promises have been given to. The one that nothing is impossible for if I believe it. I want to live like that, son. I want to have that mind. Well, I'm telling you how to get it. This is the strategy he's given. I can't say it enough. As much as the world is going to go into deep and deeper darkness, the church needs to press to deeper and deeper secret place time. Because you're going to need it to stand against the wiles of the devil. Because they're going to get more and more deceptive. It's going to be the same MO, but it's going to be cloaked in something a little different. And you aren't going to figure it out in your head. Your senses aren't going to pick it up. you're going to need to be spiritually sensitive so you're able to discern what the enemy is trying to do. That's why we get so distracted, because we're not spiritually sensitive. We know some scriptures, but we're not spiritually sensitive. Big difference. Well, you're quickened by the Spirit. You're grown in the Spirit. You begin to feel what the Spirit is feeling. You understand what I'm saying? When the Spirit is grieved, you cry. That's what I'm talking about. When he's offended, you get offended. A holy indignation. What makes God mad now makes you mad. That's the stuff I'm talking about. People cussing around you. It just, you need to stop that. That's the stuff I'm talking about. And you have a confidence to say something about it. Stop that lying. You're cheating. You're cheating, you're lying, and you're stealing. He said, don't get with darkness. He said, expose it. I'm just excited in my spirit. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. I just love Jesus. I just love Jesus. I'm about to get weirder, y'all. I'm about to get real weird. I am. It's happening. It's happening. Can somebody grab my Bible for me, please? Is my Bible somewhere around here? New Life, thank you for being here. For those of you who were able to make it to the conference, thank you. I'm telling you, it was an awesome experience. I'm still getting text messages from people. I got a text message from somebody at 3 o'clock this morning. I was up, but I'm asking them, why are you up? Texted me saying, man, that word changed my life. That atmosphere changed my life. To read something like that and say, I love you and thank you for doing it. That is the greatest encouragement anybody could ever have. Because they experienced the presence of God right here. I will never give up my faith ever again. That's what they said. What I got, I will never give it up again. Yeah. That happened right here in New Life. Yes. Yeah, if I could get that podium. So you may say, what happened? The Spirit of God fell in here. Thick. 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 To the point where even a correction was done in love and still mended. Unforgiveness couldn't even play in here. Strife couldn't even play in here. You people in here were so in love, hugging on each other. So what did we see? We saw the kingdom. We saw the kingdom. Didn't we see it, Val?
Yes, we sure did. Yes, indeed.
We saw love overflowing. We saw joy unspeakable and full of glory. So it exists. New Life. Yeah. New Life. Yeah. it exists. Welcome to the new age. Let's go. We're going to continue talking about covenant. God, I love you so much. We're going to begin with our declarative statement, which is a part of what we've been doing. We're going to read it all together. Everybody ready? On three. One, two, three. We are creating a culture of Christ-centeredness and a hunger for manifest presence. We put the word of God first, seeking his face of God in worship, prayer, and praise. We preach and teach the uncompromising word of truth. We will live in the way that pleases God. We are people who live and give honor to the Lord. We love everyone, obey the voice of the Lord, walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, and operate in excellence. We will evangelize and shake the world, and we will do it in the name of Jesus' name. I like to say in the name of Jesus, Jesus' name. Are you hearing those? We're going to keep saying those words because those words are going to get in your heart. Those words are going to live in you as you walk through your daily life, as you go to work. You're going to carry this on the inside of you. I got a hunger for Christ. I got a hunger for Christ. I don't have my papers. These are my papers. My notes, please. So we're gonna go into the covenant practices, the ceremonial practices, as we've looked at before. Those are all the ceremonial practices. I'm not gonna go through those. I'm gonna go right into the word. So let's go ahead into our word for today. We're gonna continue to talk about the exchange. Thank you, sir, so much. The exchange of the robes and the belts. Last week we were talking about David and Jonathan, and we were talking about covenant friendship. We were talking about covenant friendship, and we talked about the derobing and the identity change that happened between the two partners, between Jonathan and David, and how when Jonathan first saw David, he was smitten by David. He loved David as he loved his own soul, and he covenanted with David, and he and David did the covenant ritual just as it is there. It doesn't go through all the details. It kind of just speaks to the exchange of robe and the sword and his bow. But in that, about servanthood, it's about serving one another. The word hasid, all right? Hasid, that word meaning trustworthy, faithful, ever there, love, loving tender mercies, kindness. When you see those in the Psalms and things like that, no, you're fine. When you see that in the Psalms like that, you look that word up and that word is going to be hasid. It's going to look like C-H-E-S-E-D. Hasid, that is God's servanthood. It's a word that the Hebrews cannot put to a definition because it can't really be defined. It's God's unwavering want to serve you. Please ask me to do something for you. Please. I dare you to ask me to do something. I dare you to prove me. I dare you to challenge me on this and see won't I do it. That's the heart of it. So when you begin to covenant with God, you become circumcised, all right? Part of that covenant was circumcision. We looked to Abraham for circumcision, and Abraham was circumcision in the foreskin, all right? In a typical covenant, they typically don't do that. They usually cut somewhere the hand, the wrist, somewhere where a mark can be seen. It's usually open and it's bleeding, and then they may put some type of soot or something or ash in there so that it would clot up and make a mark. Because at some point, you know, somebody may challenge that covenant, and all you'd have to do is this. I'm in a covenant with someone, all right? So the beauty of that is that Abraham went into a covenant with God. God marked Abraham in his foreskin in an area where a man is not going to show somebody. I'm in covenant. It was in a hidden place. It was marked on his flesh, but it was hidden from the natural eye, a type and a shadow. Because what God would do through Christ is circumcise not the flesh, but the heart. Hidden from the eyes of man, but believed on the inside. Because God did not want you to see the mark. He took the mark. When he returned, what did he show the disciples? His hands and his feet. These are the marks of the new covenant. You don't have to take them. I took them for you. Are you seeing this? So now, to give you a part of this covenant, I'm not going to circumcise your flesh. I'm going to circumcise your heart. And what I'm going to put in there is to take the cold, callous heart that was dead to sin and give you my heart that's alive to God. This heart is full of compassion. This heart is full of hasid. This heart is full of servanthood. It's full of love. It is holy. It's pure. So in that circumcision, okay, so in the circumcision of our heart is this pure being that wants to be expressed in the earth. But there are things that we need to do for our heart to keep our heart protected so that we are able to walk out what God has put in here, right? We don't want to just have love. We want to demonstrate it, right? Everybody wants to demonstrate love, right? You want to be love, right? Okay, I just want to make sure I'm at the right church. You don't want to just talk about giving. You want to be a giver. You don't want to just talk about forgiveness. You want to be. Yes. Okay. We want to be that person. We want to act that out. Right? So how do we do that? What does the word tell us about that God has given us to help us walk out the life that is in us so that we are able to walk in the Spirit? All right? Because when we walk in the Spirit and we operate in the Spirit, we get the results of the Spirit life, the God kind of life, the eternal life that John 3:16 talks about. Okay? The perpetual God life. Okay? Everybody follow me? Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's go to our first scripture. Jeremiah 31:31-34, New King James Version. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them from by the hand and led them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant, which they broke it, not I broke it, they broke it, but I still was a husband to them. That's what he said, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. Keep on. Let's go. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds. I will write it in on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they shall know me, from the least to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquities and their sins. I will remember no more. Why? Because I'm going to give them a heart that has no sin in it. The inward man of the heart is who he's communicating with. That's what we got to understand. That's the part that we, the church, in our physical bodies have got to understand. God communes with you through your spirit, not your flesh. But when we commune with God, somehow we tend to look at ourselves through the outward man and try to talk to him through this person, this activity, or whatever this activity this person is doing. And because we see ourselves as the activity of the outward man, we approach God as as a lower being. Are you understand what I'm saying? We don't approach him as love coming to love. Love is in here. Love is the one he's calling. Love is the one he's talking about as righteous and virtuous and pure. Right? That's the one he's calling. That's the one that we take into his presence. You don't take your flesh into his presence. Your spirit is what he bids to come, because your flesh is not anointed to be in there. Neither is your head. It was his word that he put in you that was anointed. That's why when you come through the process of worship, you have to strip yourself of your outer self and your opinion of yourself. And you also have to strip your mind of your opinion and what you think, because you have to give your spirit full access to come into the presence of God so you can present your body a living sacrifice. Your inner man presents your outer man to God and says, use me. Your mind says yes, and your body says, I guess we all agree. And it's in that moment that the presence of God, in his presence, can rest on flesh. In an atmosphere where now power can be exuded from you, not just in you. Amen, 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 amen. So, Proverbs 4 tells us here, my son, anybody a son of God?
Amen.
Even the women, even the women. My son, pay attention to my words and be willing to learn. Open your ears to my sayings. Do not let them escape from your sight. Don't keep the word in that eye gate, right? Keep them in the center of your heart. Keep the word flowing in your heart, all right? For they are life to those who find them, and healing and health to all their flesh. Now, this is interesting because he says that the word that we need to pay attention to in 22, he says we need to find it. You have to seek it. You have to search for it with all your heart. Because if you're seeking and searching for it, he'll reveal it to you. But if you're not looking, nothing's going to be revealed. The enemy of this world will blind your eyes and you won't see the truth. Okay? So while we're seeking in the word, if we take the word into the presence of God and we begin to spend time with God, that word that we are being attended to, we are pricking our ear up to, we are searching for, we are waiting on its call. Have you ever seen anyone attending to a parent, an ailing parent? What are they doing? They're kind of just waiting that the person needs something. They call and yes, you need something? Yeah, I need a cup of water. I'll be right back. Hey, yes. And can you put ice in it? Sure. And one more thing. starting to get a little too used to this bedside rest, ain't you? Okay. That's attentive. I'm waiting on him to say something to me. I'm not always talking at him because he has the words of eternal life. He has the words of eternal life. He has given me the word of eternal life. But when the word that I'm reading and planting in my spirit and I take back to him and he then reveals to me out of that word what pertains to me, that word for me is life. So I have to be attentive to what he's saying. But if I don't know what he said, I won't know who said it. So watch your heart with all diligence. Why do we have to watch our heart with all diligence? Because we've been born again, right? This pure thing has been placed on the inside. This pure being has been placed on the inside of us. We don't want him contaminated. Why? Because from him come the issues or flow the springs of life. Life itself comes out of your inner man. So you have to keep him guarded, right? We got to keep him guarded because what we want to come out of us is what God put in there. Because we want God's results in the earth. That's what he wants in the earth. That's why he spoke that blessing in your life. Because he wants everything you touch to succeed. So he put a word in your heart, but you got to keep that word alert and alive in you so that you're always aware of it. Amen? Amen. So we have to keep it guarded. We don't want it to become dull because we're watching too much TV and we Devo in too many other shows and we got the radio blasting on the channel we know that we shouldn't be listening to and we hanging out and looking at Facebook and reading quotes from people who ain't even close to a walk with the Lord. Constantly all day long. And then when something hits your life, Lord, what do I do? What did I say in my word? I don't know. So who do I go to? Facebook. Facebook, what y'all think I should do? Put a away from you a deceitful, lying, misleading mouth. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Why? Because life is right here. The issue is in here. The flow is in here. But the life that brings forth manifestation for you in the external is right here. So if I don't guard my heart, then I put deceitful things in there. I'm deceived because I'm blind. I don't know truth. I'm blind. So I receive a lie. I sow a lie. I speak a lie. I receive a lie. Let your heart look directly ahead. Keep your eyes fixed. Don't get distracted. Towards the path, the moral courage, and let your gaze be fixed straight in front of you. Towards the path of integrity. Straight is the gate and narrow. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. Everybody doing that. Everybody's distracted, but only a few are focused. I don't care what happens. I'm going to be all right. I got my eyes fixed on the one who authored and finished my faith. Yes, sir, Jesus, that was good. Y'all don't have to say amen to that. But have you ever considered what makes that gate narrow? Pressure. Constriction. Persecution. Otherwise, Jesus should be a broad gate. Jesus, you mean eternal salvation? Everybody should be running to that. But everybody's not running to it because they're afraid of what comes with it. What they don't understand is he's already paid everything that came with it. It's paid for. And all you have to do is receive it. So the fear of tomorrow has already been taken care of. You just keep yourself in him. Stay fixed and stay focused. It doesn't matter how much pressure is trying to constrict it. You can't stay the course. Dead eye, baby. Dead eye. That's integrity. I will not stop what I'm doing. I will not compromise who I am. I ain't going to change my speech because you guys are around. I'll still pray around people. It ain't a moment of silence prayer. Don't make it a God knows my heart prayer. He does, but he needs you to vocalize something that's going to be in the earth. Consider well and watch carefully the path of your feet. Where am I going? Who am I hanging out with? Blessed is the man who does not stand in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. He said, that man is planted like a tree by the rivers of the living water that brings forth fruit in its season. That's a man who don't just go everywhere. He goes the right where. Okay. I know that didn't make, grammatical sense, but you picked up on what I was trying to say. Amen. Consider well and watch carefully the path of your feet, and all your ways will be steadfast and sure. Who's going to make sure they're steadfast and sure? The one who sent you on that way. He'll light your feet and light your path. With what? The word. Do not turn away to the right nor to the left, where evil may lurk. Turn your foot from the path of evil. Get away from evil stuff. There's some stuff the spirit don't have to tell you. You don't have to be spiritually discerning. You just know that's wrong. I don't need to be a part of this. I need to go the other way. Be a Joseph. You can take the coat, but I'm running this way. Amen. All right. So God wants us to guard this heart with all diligence. So what did he give us to guard this heart? He gave us armor. He gave us armor. It is a part of your covenant relationship with him. Because we don't fight our battles. He fights our battles. Right? But he arms us in his weaponry. Because the whole armor of God is voice activated. Yeah, it's voice activated. It works by your speech. Your armor is his words. We're going to talk about that, okay? But before we get there, we have to understand some things, okay? Because life, as my brother Kevin was just saying, life as a believer doesn't mean you are, you know, problem free. Amen. All the problems of my life have now been evaporated by the blessing. The curse is destroyed and no more problems, no more issues. No, the enemy does not stop because you have been born again. All right. He's going to try to get that word out of you so you stay, so you can be born again, but be carnally minded. Where we get a carnal Christian from? They say, but they are not exemplifying any of the life of Christ. Because they have no knowledge of him. They know him not in the power of his resurrection. Y'all, my spirit is just, woo! But I'm holding him. I'm holding on to him. Take with me your share of hardships, passing through difficulties, which you are called to endure like a good soldier of Christ. Look, so the issues are going to happen. But if you're guarded, you won't be in a situation, you'll be going through. Big difference, big time difference too. Standing in will keep you there for years. Going through can get you there in weeks, days, couple of minutes. Because now faith is. So God is not concerned with how long it takes. God is concerned with your faith. Will you believe me that I've already taken you out? Amen. Okay. No soldier in active service gets entangled in the ordinary business affairs of civilian life. He avoids them so that he may please the one who enlisted him to serve. Okay, Shep and DeVere, you got Marcus. Marcus gone, ain't he? He went and he enlisted and he's gone. He not walking around with Salem, is he? Oh, no, he's not. He ain't chumming with the boys that he used to go to school with at Reynolds. He ain't hanging out at the mall anymore. Oh, what is he doing? He's training for what? Exactly. Combat for what? For war, just in case we have one, because he's in the military, right? So when he was enlisted, he left mother and father. He left mother and father, and he went to serve the people who enlisted him, and they took him away from his civilian lifestyle because there is a new training that needs to take place for a war that could potentially happen or the service that you may need to render. I pray he never has to go to war. But he's still going to provide a service to this country. But he's got to be prepared to do it. He can't be here hanging out with us. Because I know nothing about what he got to do in service. I'm a pastor, but I can't shepherd you in that one right there, bro. You're going to have to go to the one that enlisted you so that they can renew your mind to a new way of living. You don't do it like that anymore. Because in the setting that you may be put in, you can't eat for 4 hours. You got to cut that time down, buddy, because you got some other assignments you got to do. You can't miss certain times. Right, brother? Can't miss certain times. Why? Because there's other lives on the line. Body of Christ. There's certain things you can't lapse on because there are other lives on the line. So you have got to give yourself back to God because he enlisted you through Jesus Christ and you now serve in the army of God. And when the one enlisted you calls you, you need to report for duty. But if you haven't left the world, you're always going to fight the call. Amen? Amen. But all this has to do with guarding this heart. Because it is what we take in that causes us to make the decisions that we make. Out of it flow the issues of life. The decisions I made are all a product of what I've put in. You squeeze me, and this is what you're going to get out. I love the way Brother Kevin said that. I've been putting it in and putting it in and putting it in and putting it in, and all of a sudden, just. Guess what? You don't have to know like 17,000 scriptures to get God's power to start moving. You just speak a word. That's how simple he is. Speak a word that I gave you, and I can act on that because it's done in faith. And the measure of your heart is speaking through that one word. Did you just catch what I said? The measure of your heart is speaking through that one word, because all of you was in that word. God said, light be. Everything of God was in light be. It wasn't just a piece of him that made light. It was all of him that made light. It radiated out of him. And what do you think is happening in the spirit realm when you take the word and you light is happening? It is piercing darkness. Back to my spot and back to our regular scheduled scripture already in progress. Verse 5, and if anyone competes in an athletic, in competitive games, he is not crowned with the wreath of victory unless he competes according to the rules. You're not going to win the fight unless you know how God told you to fight. We're going to talk about that here in just a second. I play football and I understand that there are rules to the game. There's certain things you just can't do in the game. You're going to get flagged. It's a penalty. You could lose the game. You could lose yards. People get penalized, can get kicked out of a game. There are certain things, according to the word, according to this blessing, that God said, look, I want to bless your life. But if you're walking around here, profane words coming out of your mouth, hating, cheating, lying, and stealing, killing, adultery, and all this other stuff going on, don't expect this to work for you. I want it to, but you haven't left the civilian life. You enlisted, but you went AWOL. So what I need you to do, you can't do because you don't even know protocol. I know that's rough, but I'm taking you somewhere. The hardworking farmer who labors and produces crops ought to be the first to receive the share of the crops. If you're putting in, you ought to be the one receiving. Some joker come up there saying, can I get some? When I'm done. Were you here when I started? Did you help me pull weeds? Did you help me till? Did you help me do anything? And you're going to come and think you're going to get the first part of this best? No. No, 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 no. That's not how this works. That's not how God works. Man don't work. Ooh, that's rough. 7, think over the things I am saying. Grasp their application. For the Lord will grant you insight and understanding in everything. Again, Paul is writing to Timothy. Paul is in chains now, y'all. He in prison. Okay, he's writing all this information from prison, okay? So he's saying this to a young Timothy, and he's saying, everything I'm telling you, the Lord is going to reveal to you what it means, okay? And you're going to be able to teach this to other people. Let's go. Remember, Christ, the ever-living Lord, who has risen from the dead as a prophesied king, descended from David, king of Israel, according to my gospel, the good news that I preach. For that gospel, I am suffering even the point of wearing chains like a criminal. But listen, the word of God is not chained or in prison. It does not matter if I'm standing here physically chained and linked to walls and can't move. The word that I'm sending you is enough to get around and still get people saved. You can't chain up the word of God. You can't burn all the books in the world to try to get rid of it. It just keeps coming back. Amen. You try to kill all the people off, but another people rise up. Amen. You cannot get rid of the word of God. My word will stand forever. Amen. Heaven and earth can pass away, but my word shall never pass away. Jesus, Jesus. So what did God do for us to get us in a position where we could keep all of these things in order and get this heart protected so that we are able to churn out of us the purity of the life of Christ? That's what we're aiming for, right? We're aiming for the life of Christ. We want to live like him and we want to do what he commissioned us to do, the greater works that he wasn't even able to do. And we want to be a demonstration to that so that people would come to him because some people just not going to believe it until they see it. Amen? Most people won't, especially the ones living in deep darkness. You're going to have to prove something for them to turn. That's where we're going, amen? So let's go. And next scripture is, I think it's Ephesians. Yes, Ephesians 6. In conclusion, after he's talked about being good to the family and the wives and all of this, he said, in conclusion, be strong in the Lord, draw your strength from him, and be empowered through your union with him and in the power of his boundless might. Look at that beautiful scripture in Amplified Version. Be strong in the Lord. In him, meaning you acknowledge him, you know him, you live in his life is your life. You are wrapped in him. When they look at you, they see him. Be strong in him. His might is going to be your might. He fits you like a glove. And in the power of his boundless might, John said about Jesus, the one whom God has sent, he has given him the spirit without measure. Oh my God, that's so beautiful, Christian. Jesus has this limitless supply of the spirit. He can do whatever he needs to do by the power of the spirit. If it's not in the earth, Jesus can make it happen. Otherwise, the devil wouldn't have no reason to say, if I turn these stones into bread. But he couldn't do it. Apparently, he could do that. Why? Because he had the spirit without measure. There was no depth to how much he could possibly do. There was no cap on how far he could go. Because there is no limit on the spirit. The only limit we put on the spirit is the thing we won't do when he tells us to do it. We cap him off. It's called grieving him. The Holy Spirit is a gentleman. If you recognize in Luke 4, I'm just going off on a little tangent. It's a Bible tangent. So it's not a personal story tangent. It's a Bible tangent. When Jesus received the Holy Spirit, how did the Holy Spirit come? Like a dove, in bodily form, like a dove. A dove is a gentle bird. Easily, just you could do anything, any shift, any move, he gone. He's gentle. He's not like a vulture, like an eagle. He don't tear away at stuff. He's gentle. He's quiet. He rests. And the Holy Spirit came, and he rested on Jesus, the gentleman. But when we begin to get out of control, we grieve him. Let's do this. I can't. What are you doing? No. You just let the power leave. So be strong in him in the power of his boundless might. Put on the full armor of God, for his precepts are like our splendid armor of a heavenly armed soldier, so that you may be able to successfully stand against all the schemes and the strategies and deceits of the devil. Now, this is why you need to have this armor on, because the lies of the enemy, who tries to blind the eyes through deception, are being fired at you all day long. And you need something that is not physical to discern it. Because we're going to read the next scripture that tells us that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, contending with only with physical opponents, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world's forces of the present darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural places. Therefore, this next thing is telling us why we need that, because these areas right here are the realms of ranking in demonic force. The higher your level of influence, the higher your level of demonic force. And the church needs to understand that there is a demonic force out there. There are devils and demons out there, okay? Don't be afraid to say that. There are people who get possessed. But guess what you're supposed to do? Cast them out. You don't go, oh my God, they're shaking and doing all kind of stuff. You go in there in the power of Jesus. He didn't, oh my God, this dude demoniac of Gadara. Oh my Lord. This dude out here scaring folk. Hell no, we're going to go around, y'all. We're going to get back on the boat. We're going to go around to the other port. No. You mean, no. Who are you? And what you doing? Oh, don't. They bow down. Don't do nothing to us. Don't do nothing. You, Jesus, you just said it. Shut up. You don't talk to me like that. Get out of this mess. Let's let us go into the pigs. Go. How hard was that? It wasn't a whole big seance and bring a cross and get some holy water and get some lights and make a movie and walk around them four times and speak to the walls of Jericho and pray for four more hours. And he was prepared when he got there. The work had already been done with the Father in the secret place, so that when he came out of the secret place and into the world, he was already walking in the new and fresh revised power. Think about it. Think about it. Jesus. The woman touched him. It's your blood, right? She touched him. And he turned and said, "Who touched me?" Why did he turn around and say, "Who touched me?" Because it said virtue left him. His power supply just got depleted a little bit. She touched him by faith. She reached out and placed a demand on glory. She put her hand on supernatural, and supernatural went into her, changed her blood. And when he felt it, he said, "Who touched me?" Something just left me. That's how sensitive he was to the power of the Holy Spirit. He knew the lady didn't even touch his body. Just the spit of the clothes. You can't feel that. But just doing that, she got what she came for, and he felt it. So you say, why do I need to pray? So that you can be powered up. Therefore, put on the complete armor of God so that you are able to successfully resist and stand your ground in the evil day of danger, having done everything that the crisis demands, to stand firm in your place, fully prepared, immovable, victorious, right? Because the enemy is trying all the schemes he can. But if you have this weaponry on, you could just stand there. I can do this all day, man. It's not hitting anything but my faith. I put up my shield of faith. And like I said, this armor is all voice activated because it's all according to the word. The spirit realm does not work on physical products. It works on the word. Words operate this realm of the spirit. Words. Words. Somebody say that with me. Words. Words operate the realm of the spirit. You won't see supernatural living. Get the word of the super in your natural. And release it from your natural into a realm of super. And super will come on your natural and produce supernatural. Amen. So stand firm and hold your ground, having tightened your band of truth, personal integrity, and moral courage around your waist, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, an upright heart, and having strapped on your feet the gospel of peace in preparation to face the enemy with firm footing, stability, and the readiness produced by the good news above all. Look at that. What it says? Above all of these, you make sure you have lifted up the protective shield of faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. You can know all about righteousness and salvation and holiness and all of that, but if you ain't working the faith, it's not going to do anything for you. You got to begin to plant it in your heart and sow it out of your mouth and act on it. Amen? Is that making sense? Is that making sense? You have to act on what he's put in you and what you have put in through the hearing and the seeing and the meditating of the word. You have to let faith come by hearing. That's why it's good to read your Bible out loud. Not just in your head. Say the words. Think about it again. When you sow those words out there, not only are you sowing them in your heart, but you're also sowing it out into a spiritual harvest, an atmosphere that is producing for you a good work. It is making a way for you. It is causing all things to work together for your good. That word can't return to you void, even when you're reading it out loud. Think about that. You're not like reading it just like to say, do this and do that. You just might be just reading just in general. But the words flowing out of your mouth are causing something to be affected. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. The curse has been broken. For Christ has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. You might just be reading that, just going through the scriptures. But what you have done is just put in the atmosphere, I'm not afraid. And the world has to respond to that. Above all, lift up the protective shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. All right, let's go. And take on the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And look at this, with all of this, put this in prayer and petition. With specific request, meaning you take that word and you take it back to the Father in communication. This is what your word says about this situation. Amen? Because the Father has something to say about that word that he wrote for you to read, to search out and to find. Because when you take it back to him, he has a word on it. Yes, that's what I said about it. And this is what I'm telling you. So now your logos has become a rhema. Amen. Your communion has become a revelation of light that is now a communing bread that is now feeding you back. So it's not just you reading an account anymore. It's making you a living epistle. It's writing it on your heart. It's revisioning you. This is what you thought your end was going to be, but this is what I rewrote it, and this is my plan about it. got a thought about it, and I got a purpose for it. But now that you're in here talking to me about it, Kevin, you need to go get a house. What? My view says I can't get a house? But you hadn't seen my view. I'll give you houses that you didn't build. Come by without money. Come by without money. How do you do that? How do you buy something without currency to buy it? Faith. Because faith is the supernatural currency of heaven. That's God's currency. If you got my currency trumps natural currency. So if it's healing you need, you don't have to pay a doctor. You come to me. I save you all those doctor fees. You can take that money and put it into a good work. Ain't this good, y'all? Okay. The word is always good. So with prayer, petition, specific request at all times, on every occasion, in every season. So it doesn't matter what season you're in. You could be on the high point of life. Everything is rolling gray. Everything is good. That's not the time to start reading the word and praying. Why are you living high on life? Because I'm telling you, fall is coming. Winter is coming. To everything, there is a season. It's coming. But you have to prepare yourself with preparation. Whew. In the spirit. Look at that. Look at that. Not only praying in your understanding, but also praying in the spirit. Some of us not born again. And you're missing out on some amazing power and benefits. Because nothing will charge you more than praying in the spirit. Nothing will charge you more than praying in the Holy Ghost. There is no more pure prayer language than praying in the Holy Spirit. You are praying the perfect will of God. You are praying mysteries to God that only He can interpret. I can't even put it into words. You have to take that moment with Him, and you just yield yourself. You just yield yourself, and what comes out of you is a spring of language. It is the Bible calls it a groaning. It's like an eruption. It's an eruption of language that God speaks through you to Himself. It's like God thinking His thoughts out loud. Through you. He's talking in His language to Himself through you, about you. He's not talking about Himself. He's talking about you. Because you're in a situation that you may not even know you're in. Or someone else may be in a situation that you haven't been made aware of. It's the reason why it's called intercession. There's a crossroad there. Somebody's in a situation that they can't talk about. They don't know what to do. But He puts a burden on your heart. He wakes you up because He knows you'll pray. God, what is it? I don't know what I'm praying about. Maybe there might be an unction on the inside of you. Maybe a name will come to you. Maybe a situation might come to you. Maybe the name of a church might come to you. Whatever it is. Maybe it might be a vision or a picture He shows you. An image. Just start praying. Yeah, what is it, Father? What is it, Christian? Father, I thank you for Christian. Whatever his situation he's in, I thank you that he is the redeemed of the Lord, and I say so. I step in on his behalf. I intercede on his behalf, and by faith, I call him saved from any hurt, harm, or danger. And in the midst of that prayer, the Holy Ghost will begin to bubble up on the inside of you, and he will say, I know what he's going through. I know what the problem is. Let me pray. At that point, you tell your mind, be quiet. And you tell your body, chill. God got something to say. And you let him talk. You let him speak. And Paul said, if you want to know what he's talking about, ask. He said, he'll interpret it for you. Lord, what am I praying about? And he'll tell you. Because that's the relationship we have with him. There's no mystery in him. Even if it's a mystery language, he'll tell you what you're talking about. Oh, what an awesome God we serve. You do not know the benefits you got. If you don't know the Holy Ghost, I want to make sure that you get him today if you want him. Because he said if you ask, he'll give it to you. If I, as a natural father, know how to give good gifts to my children, what more would the Father give you who would ask, would he not give you the Holy Ghost? The best gift he could ever give you? Better than your car? Better than your new promotion? Better than, you know, your new girlfriend, new boyfriend? All of that good. It's better than all of that. It's a personal walk with the Holy Ghost. that was free. The church needs the Holy Ghost. There is no power without him. You're just a good Christian trying to do right. But with the Holy Ghost, you become the Son. You are no longer a child. You are ready to step out into sonship. Because the Holy Ghost coming on you is going to turn you into a son. You ready to do Father's business. I want to pull a mama right now, but I can't leave the church. If you didn't know my mama, she would have took off and ran outside. She'd have been out there yelling and walking up and down the sidewalk. That's what I want to do right now. But I'm preaching, so I can't really do that. So again, I'm going to finish this up. Good Lord. Good Lord. He is a good Lord. Record these scriptures. They are all speaking to the helmet of salvation, the shield of faith. Again, all of these are the word of God. All of them are the word of God. They are the word you speak. They are the words you keep in your memory and remember and meditate on. They are the word that you walk out, because the issue that's fighting you is not physical, it's spiritual. So the way that you fight it or combat it or defend yourself or get on the offensive is to use the word, because the word is the only thing that is spirit that can shut down everything he's throwing at you. And with your prayer, now your word becomes a directive action that you act out, you walk out, and everything that he tries to throw at you, you not only speak against, but you also counterattack with action. You guard that heart so that he's not able to get in. He's not able to infect you with bitterness or the curse. He's not able to poison you with lies. And you are able to keep your body pure before God. And that's the kind of body he's trying to work through. We make no shortages. We don't make any shortcuts. There are no spikes in our relationship. We walk on this consistent power band. And when he calls me, I'm always ready. Anybody want to live like that? Well, when he calls you, you are always ready. In season, out of season. You're always ready. You always got a word on your mouth. And you always got power on your flesh. These hands were made for healing. They help me eat and catch stuff too, but. You know, sometimes I might have to spank my kid with one, but they're for healing. They were for laying on of hands, not slapping, not punching, healing. These feet were meant to take peace wherever I go. They were meant to make peace. I can't go into teaching that, but there's a difference. A peacemaker and a peacekeeper. Peacemakers may not always agree. Peacemakers might shake some stuff up. But when they leave, you know they were telling you the truth. I thank the Lord. Can we just stand up? Just lift our hands to the Lord. Take these scriptures and meditate on them. Guard your heart with all diligence. Your covenant partner has given you the armor to fight. He's given you the armor to fight. Not your armor, not your strength, not your power, not your resources. He has covered you with his word to defend you. When the enemy is looking at you, he's not seeing you, he's seeing him. When David went to Saul to fight Goliath, what did Saul try to do? He tried to put his arm on David. David said, this stuff don't fit, man. I can't fight him in this. I have a covenant with God. I have a covenant with God, and my covenant partner is going to cover me. I have armor on that you don't see. I done put the word out on this situation, and I'm covered in armor that you don't see. And today that giant's going down. And some of us need to begin to talk to the issues in our life the very same way. I don't need the world's opinion and their armor. I have a covenant with God. And he has covered me with his word. And these issues that I'm looking at right now, they're coming down. They can't take you out. They're coming down. Father, I speak that over their life right now in the name of Jesus. This atmosphere is perfect for breakthrough. Hallelujah. So I speak to breakthrough in each life right now in Jesus' name. To all who will receive it, to any who will take it by faith, who will open their mouths and receive their breakthrough right now in the name of Jesus. I speak it into the atmosphere. Healing, financial breakthrough, clarity and understanding, new vision, whatever it needs to be, Father. You know what's on their heart. You know what they need. And you already have an answer and a plan for it. So since you're already here, we're just going to make that request right now. We're going to make that request right now. We're going to, whatsoever thing we desire right now when we pray, we're going to believe that we receive it and we have it. We expect right now, turn around. We expect right now, breakthrough. We expect right now provision. Yes. We expect right now new vision. Yes. We expect right now resources. Yes. We expect right now healing. Yes. We expect right now restoration, yes. Revitalization, yes. A refreshing. Yes. We expect it. Yes. Because it is your good pleasure to give your children the kingdom. So we just receive what you have already freely given. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just remind the enemy that you are a liar. And we're going to win no matter what you try to say. We're going to win no matter how many darts you throw. But today we lift up the standard. We raise the shield of faith up. And we say with our mouth, we have been made more than conquerors. We are overcomers in this life. We thank you for that. We thank you for that. That we are the head and not the tail. That we are above only and not beneath. Thank you for that. We are the lender, not the borrower. We thank you. We are reconcilers in this earth. We are ministers of reconciliation. Hallelujah. We are ambassadors of the kingdom of God. We are the children of light. We are the salt of the earth. We are the light in this world. We are the city set upon a hill that cannot be hidden. We are the body of Christ. We are the glorious bride. And we say so. We've been redeemed of the Lord. And we say so. Hallelujah. And we thank you for that. We receive it right now by faith. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Somebody give God praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Pick that word up on Monday. Amen. Don't let the whole day go by and you not talk to him, not spend any time with him. Pick it up. Get with him. I'm promising you, he's going to start saying some stuff to you that's going to open up your heart and mind. I believe it and you receive it. Be blessed. Tuesday prayer, Wednesday night, Bible study. Love you. God bless.